Our first veteran is Staff Sergeant Cody, escorted in by Michael Wolowski. Served in the Marine Corps from 2005 to present. Our next veteran is Mr. James Fadden, who served in the Navy from 1954 to 1958, escorted by Seamus and Brynn Fadden. Escorted by Abby and Anna Harvey, and Maisie, Camden, and Ian Anderson. Welcome our next veteran, Mr. Jack McDonald, who served in the U.S. Navy in Vietnam from 1958 to 1972, escorted by Caitlin Huntoon. Cameron and Liam Manning. Escorting Mr. Charles Harrington, who served in the Army from 1956 to 1958. Please welcome Mr. Jay Bartlett, who served in the Coast Guard from 1980 to 1984. He is escorted by Zena Bartlett. Please welcome Mr. Patrick Walls, who served in the United States Air Force as a nuclear weapons specialist from 1975 to 1998. He is escorted today by Charity Dion. Please welcome Mr. Mike Novak, who served in the Army from 1978 to 1998. He is escorted by Sam Bromlich and Vienna Rand. In the Navy on the USS Lexington during the Vietnam War from 1971 to 1975, escorted by Colt Southern and Gabby Kirkpatrick. Grandfather Ernest Fay, who served in the Navy from 1940 to 1944, and Kylie Claremont is carrying a photo of her other great-grandfather, Wilbur Siegman, who served in the Navy from 1942 to 1946.
Escorted by Emily Rich. Welcome to Dan Kennison,
77th Engineer Battalion from 1966 to 1967 in Vietnam, escorted by Marjorie Keniston. Air Cavalry Division from 1962 to 1982, escorted by Ava Wright.
We will now have the history of the candle lighting ceremony.
This candle is reminiscent of the light of hope, which lives in our hearts to illuminate their way away from their captors to the open arms of a grateful nation. Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
Thank you.
Miss Emily Rich is going to give us a reading.
You were brave. Were you also afraid? would like to invite up Major Benjamin Roy, United States Marine Corps Reserves.
If I could, can I speak from here?
Certainly.
Hi, I'm Ben Roy, Major, United States Marine Corps Reserve. I fly the AH-1 Whiskey Super Cobra attack helicopter. And I didn't quite plan ahead. Now, does anybody have a pen? Do you have an air pen?
Well, I'm actually going to need people with pens, so if you're going to have to write for yourself. Nobody? Make sure I'll throw the pair of dying.
Six words
that have absolutely no application today. Okay, so with that out of the way, the rest of the Gettysburg Address, every last word of it, I don't need to adjust anything of it. You know, you can look it up on your mobile phone later on after I'm done speaking, they only have 10 minutes. But every last bit of the words Abraham read or spoke in the Gettysburg Address is word for word applicable to today. He put it in perspective. He's reading at Gettysburg Battlefield, not during the Battle of Gettysburg, which I thought when I was in high school. It's in November. It's also November now. It's realistically, it was November 19th. So 9 days from now would be the anniversary of the Gettysburg Address. And he's speaking on the Gettysburg Battlefield, which had just happened 4 months ago in July, the first couple days of July in 1863. So, Abraham Lincoln is speaking at the battlefield, which he kind of feels that he drove. He drove that battlefield, and to put it in perspective, he's dedicating a cemetery, and in that cemetery is 4,000, well, there were 4,000 deaths at Gettysburg. They're not all at Gettysburg, but 4,000 people died there. Put that in perspective, that's everybody from Camden to Knox. And you want to think about who took bullets in, not just everyone who had to get hospitalized, but everybody from Plymouth all the way to Lilith. And I want to keep it light, so I don't want to go any deeper into that. But that's a lot of people, and that weight is right on Abraham Lincoln's shoulders. He's sitting there, surrounded by the loved ones, these casualties, and he's got to say a speech. How do you write a speech for that? I'll tell you how I write a speech for that. I take what Abraham Lincoln said, and I turn it around, and basically it all fits today. And he starts off very sterile, that four scores 7 years ago, I don't even know what a score is, but 7 years ago, that our fathers brought forth on this continent a nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the principles that all men are created equal. Great, everybody can kind of agree with that. And then he goes, and now we're in a great civil war. We're met on a battlefield of that war. That battlefield of that war. See whether that nation, or any nation so conceived, Galt, Linwood, we're met on that same battlefield. Is democracy done? Is the United States going to be perfect like last night's homework? It's continuing. It's still going on. Because of that, whether or not it survives or not depends on everyone in this room. So he goes on and he says, we're here to dedicate the cemetery, and it's good that we do this. And realistically, it's great that we are doing this. When I was a kid, and I was talking about this with my wife, we didn't do a Veterans Day celebration. After I get done here, I'm going to Bathfield School for my kids. And we were trying to figure out, we never did this. I don't even know if we talked about it with my parents. Probably another day at work when I got off of school the next day from my dad, realistically. But it's good that we do that for this reason. And that's what Lincoln's saying. But he also goes on to say that nothing we do, nothing I say here, that it pales in comparison. There's no way I can possibly add or subtract away from what the guys behind me did to what the leaders around us built. So, Abraham Lincoln has always thought of democracy as an experiment. Well, realistically, the nation in 1863 was less than 100 years old. We had a rough start. We had to fight for 10 years to get our independence. We got our capital burned in 1812, which we'll come back to in a few minutes. And now here we are, and we are ripping each other apart in the Civil War in 1863 with a body count that is setting records. So he doesn't know. He doesn't know in a year from now whether or not that country will still exist. So he goes on to say,
It's good that we dedicate this, but we're not going to add anything. So instead of trying to add something to this land by being here today, while we're dedicating this land, we should dedicate ourselves. Dedicate ourselves to the unfinished business. It is up to us, the living, to dedicate ourselves, is his exact words, or at least something close to it, don't quote me. And he goes on, and he wraps the whole thing up, to say that it's up to us to dedicate ourselves to ensure that a nation of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish. Which brings me back around to Francis Scott Key. When I was in high school, I looked at the national anthem like a declaration of American awesomeness. We are unstoppable force, and we will sing this national anthem, the home of the brave, and the fly over at the Super Bowls, it was a rock on at the moment, every time I heard that. But 15 years of military experience made me realize something. And I hate to call you out, you're the only one, but realistically I would have done the exact same thing. When you write down the end of the national anthem, it's not a declaration. Our national anthem is a question. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? That's a question. If you want to do me one favor, on this Veterans Day, treat the national anthem like it's a question. Francis Scott Key wrote that when he was a prisoner of war in Baltimore Harbor, watching American soil get bombarded. He didn't know when he woke up in the morning whether or not Baltimore was going to be a British colony again. He didn't know when he woke up, whether or not he woke up a year from now, or from then, the nation would ever even endure. Now I will say, in the words of Lincoln, that the nation would endure. Now I will say, thanks to the folks behind me, and great folks like Mr. Nelson, and folks, your leaders, someone else is going to raise and lower the flag for the rest of your life. That's kind of a safe bet, but that's not the entire question. The rest of the question is, oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave, or what? Or the land of the free and the home of the brave. So, if you want to do me one favor on Veterans Day, from here on out, for every time you hear the national anthem, I want you to think, am I free? And am I being brave? And there's only one way to answer that question. And it's with your actions. You can't do it by promising it. You have to live free. Live a license plate. Live free. Be brave. And that's my one favor. If you can give me two favors on Veterans Day, then I will say, great, thank the veteran, but make sure when you see that veteran, look to his left and to his right, or her left and her right, and find his or her spouse. Because realistically, I chose this. Don't thank me on Veterans Day. I fly a helicopter for a living. Thank you all for paying my parts, gas, and but my wife, she just made the mistake of choosing me. Thank your spouse. They are half of the warrior. And they really don't get a tenth of the credit. One last point. I am a Marine, and being a Marine, today is November 10th. Thank you. 241 days ago, today, the very first Marines were recruited in a bar in Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. So it's Marines, past, present, and future, happy birthday, keep winning. And to the rest of you, thanks for having me. Have a great long weekend. And
the Marines, the Army, the Coast Guard, the Air Force, and the Navy.
perform. Thank you, soldiers. introduce Ms. Virginia Doyle for the class.
Good morning, everyone, students, faculty, amazing honored guests, our veterans, all the parents in the audience. I joined the Linwood staff in July, and since I've arrived, I've been really overwhelmed by the amazing sense of friendship and love and community, and it's really been poignant today because this has been an amazing celebration of our veterans. I can't even begin to say what part of today I think is the best. I am blown away by how talented our students are. I'm really so impressed with how well behaved my elementary students are. And I'm so honored to meet so many of the amazing veterans from our surrounding community and our community. I wanted to take a moment to thank all of you for coming and for participating, especially our Boy Scouts, our ROTC. You guys were all just so wonderful and so talented with those flags, really impressive. There is going to be a little bit more to the ceremony, but I wanted to take this time just to thank each and every one of you. Thank the veterans for their service, and their spouses. That's a very important part too. I'll remember that for you. Thank you so much. Have a very blessed Veterans Weekend.
Senior Master Sergeant Bailey Harrington, Corporal Colin Coffin, Rogue's Distinguished Lieutenant. Thank you. Ms. King will call the veterans to the exit. Thank you so much for coming here today.
Please remain standing as our veterans exit the room. Veterans, we thank you for your service. We thank you for coming today.